So as just as I had said in the last video, what we're going to be spending the most time on is regions within the forebrain and regions within diencephalon, which include the thalamus and the hypothalamus. And so within the cerebral cortex, we have four lobes. We have the frontal lobe, and this controls motor and executive functions. This is right here. We have the parietal lobe, which is tactile, spatial, and attention functions. We have the temporal lobe here, which has auditory, memory, and gustatory functions. And we have visual, the occipital cortex here, which is visual information. So you can see the central sulcus separates the frontal lobe and the parietal lobe. And the lateral sulcus, or also known as the lateral fissure, separates the temporal lobe and the frontal lobe. And this is known as the longitudinal fissure that separates the right and left hemispheres. Now, there's a couple of primary blood vessels that supply oxygen and nutrients to the brain. There's three main arteries. We have the anterior cerebral artery, the middle cerebral artery, and the posterior cerebral artery. So, of course, the anterior, if it's called the anterior cerebral artery, then it would supply to, and normally I would pause with the class of this, but the anterior portion of the brain. So this primarily supplies a great deal blood flow to the front of the brain. And you can see here, this is the dorsal view, and this lateral view, that it covers this sort of whole anterior and dorsal portion. Then you have the middle cerebral artery, and this goes right up. This is lateral, so you can see it's only in the lateral view, but it basically goes up the sides. Okay, so you'll have the middle of the brain right on either side, and it does not really supply a whole lot of oxygenation to the middle. And then you have the posterior cerebral artery, and this is the ventral view, so mainly this takes care of the back. The back, the posterior, and the ventral, and you can see here in this medial view that it covers a lot of the occipital lobes and parts of the temporal lobes. And they don't have the middle view here, but as you can see, the anterior, it comes up through the whole midline, so it covers the middle part of the brain. Okay, so there's two types of strokes that you can have. And this is actually, it has to do with one of the writing reflection prompts that you have for your first writing reflection. So you can have an ischemic stroke in which a blood vessel is blocked. Okay, so it could be blocked by a clot, and this is what a lot of people are familiar with. You can also have a hemorrhagic stroke. And this is in which a blood vessel bursts and causes bleeding into the brain. So both of these are highly, highly problematic. If, for both of them, if a blood vessel is blocked or if it's bleeding, if you happen to block, for example, a blood vessel right here, so say you have in the middle cerebral artery, then all of this over here it would not be getting any oxygen. And if you had this break here or it burst here, all of this wouldn't be getting any oxygen. And blood would also be flowing into the brain in this area. And you have a limited amount of space in the brain. So if blood flows, if you have a hemorrhagic stroke, then also blood leaks into the brain and it causes pressure, which can also cause problems. This pressure can be relieved in various ways, but if it's not, then it's like trying to fit more blood into this tight place. The skull can't give, but the brain can, so the blood is actually gonna put pressure on the brain. And here we have the ventricles and CSF that you can see in the beginning. So the ventricles provide, are filled with cerebral spinal fluid. So you have the left lateral ventricle and right over here, that's kind of behind it. And this, this is the right lateral ventricle and this is the left lateral ventricle. And then you can see them better here on the side view. The lateral ventricle, you'd have one on the right, one on the left. This is the third ventricle, and this is the fourth ventricle. And this is your cerebral aqueduct, which is going to connect them. These will connect with your spinal cord, which is also filled with cerebral spinal fluid. Cerebral spinal fluid, it fills the ventricles, and it circulates around the brain and the spinal cord in the subarachnoid space. And it cushions the brain, and there are also some fundamental nutrients. You can also theoretically get infections or have diseases that would affect the cerebrospinal fluid, and that can then therefore greatly affect spinal cord function and brain function. But on the whole, you know, they're going to function to cushion the brain, and we'll be talking about a little them more in detail. We have a couple types of cells that primarily comprise the brain. Most people are familiar with neurons. They at a basic level, they know that, you know, what type of cells do you have in your brain? You have neurons. And neurons carry information. They're really critical for function. And but what people also don't realize is that you also have glial cells, okay? And the glial cells, and we'll be talking about these more, these aid and modulate neuronal activity, okay? So if you might have neurons, which are really key for central communication, it could be kind of like, you know, the heating and electrical lines in your house, that nothing functions without it. The glial cells are going to be the support that you that your neurons need to sort of rest on aspects of these glial system, the glial cells. They help keep everything clean. They take away debris. They can help in repair. They provide structural support. So the neurons, which are of course they carry out the brain's primary functions, they are two types of matter that are made up of the cells in the brain. One is gray matter, and this is areas of the nervous system predominantly composed of cell bodies and blood vessels. So this would be these regions right around here, okay? So these are your cell bodies. At your cell bodies, you have all of these dendrites that stick out, and this is what communicates with other neurons. So gray matter is primarily comprised of the cell bodies and the connection points between neurons and cells, okay? White matter, on the other hand, these are the areas of the nervous system that are rich in the fat sheathed neuronal axons, okay? So that's these areas right here. So these, the white matter is the axons, the long part here, that that is going to be connecting, you know, the neuron here, with, I mean, the cell body neuron with other parts of, other neurons in other parts of the brain, or peripheral nerves in the body. So these axons can be very long. So I'm going to have axons that go from, you know, my brain all the way to the end of my arm. Axons travel down the length of your spinal cord. And so if you cut these, in some areas they can be repaired, in some areas they can't. And when you have groupings of these axons, okay, these will form the nerve tracts. And then you also have a corpus callosum. This is a fiber system connecting the two cerebral hemispheres. And we'll be talking more about the corpus callosum in later chapters, because people behave very differently when the corpus callosum is cut. And there are rare conditions, usually for very, very severe epilepsy, in which the person has loss of seizures, that you would cut the corpus callosum to prevent the seizure that begins in one part of the brain spreading to the whole part of the brain. Okay, so now we're going to watch a couple of videos. So what you're about to see is the activity of a participant who is watching a ad, and you'll be able to see what areas of the brain are activating while they're watching this ad. And this is an example of gray matter in action. So right over here is your is a representation of the brain. This is the frontal lobes, this is the temporal lobes, this is the occipital lobe, and wherever this activity begins, wherever the colors appear, that means that the brain is significantly more active in this area, or whatever area it is, than other areas of the brain. So just watch how the brain activity, what areas are lighting up, moves around the brain, and how that actually corresponds with what they're viewing and possibly, and highly likely, what they're thinking. This is where they're looking. You can see here, nice amount of activation up in the top of the frontal lobe here along the sides. You'll be learning more about what these regions do later. This is the bottom of the brain. Excuse me, the top of the brain. This is the bottom of the brain. So pretty cute. So now this is actually going to be a very different video. This is going to show you some of the white matter tracts in the brain. And this white matter tracts is the connectivity between gray matter areas. So what you see here, the way they have the information coded in here, this sort of white is actually the gray matter, and this gray is the what would be called the white matter. So try not to get too confused by that. It's just a neuroimaging contrast. So you'll be able to see here, and here is sort of the gray matter folds, and this is where you do a lot of your higher order thinking. And then in between here is the connectivity between these regions so that the neurons can communicate with each other. So what you're going to see in this video is a sort of a visual connectivity map, where you'll see an individual drawing a cursor around the brain to show what is connecting with that region. It looks pretty cool. So here they're going to go inside. You'll even see even closer. They're showing the different tracks that are going through the various regions. So these would be representative of individual sort of neural fiber tracks. You go even closer, you can see how many there are. And all of the connections are... So here, it's pulling his cursor along and showing like, okay, well, what fiber tracks are connecting with that? So sometimes you get really long tracks that move from one area to another. Some of the times they're regional in terms of looking more with it, the specifics of that area. So this is one large track. This is what's called a seed region. They point to that little ball. So it looks for what tracks are passing through that that seed region. So there's a really nice track that goes the ventral and dorsal. Here's a 3D representation of the brain. And then you'll be able to see how some of the tracks travel through it.